Next, we have a short video introduction to our keynote speaker from Alex Stepanoff. Alex Stepanoff is the creator of the STL, and he's not able to be with us today, but he's here by video. So if we could have that now.
It is impossible to talk about Bjarne Stroustrup without talking about C++. And I love C++. Why do I love it? Why do I think it is so wonderful? There are three main reasons for that. And the primary reason for which I love C++ is that it is a language which allows me to see bits. It allows me to see sequences of zeros and ones in the computer, which is the best, the most universal way to represent the reality. And it is so sad that many people consider this representation something as a low-level thing. It isn't. After all, the binary numbers as a universal way of encoding reality were first suggested by Leibniz, hardly a low-level person. It was introduced as the foundation of computing by Alan Turing. And we should not be ashamed of bits. We should be proud of them. We should view our activity of encoding reality into bits as a glorious activity. The second property of C++, which I love, is that it allows me to talk about addresses of these bit sequences. That was the second fundamental idea behind modern computers. First was the binary memory introduced by Turing. But it was a bit complicated. It required linear access to get to a particular bit sequence. The random access memory, which one could argue was introduced by von Neumann, uses a bit sequence as an address which allows you to get to its value. This ability to deal with addresses is a remarkable property which allows us to implement all kind of complicated data structures to represent whatever parts of reality we're dealing with. The third remarkable property of C++ is its ability to take these bit sequences and provide them with abstract semantics to map these bit sequences onto however advanced abstractions which we could borrow from mathematics or develop ourselves. When Bjarne started designing C++ at the end of the 70s in 1979, he quickly articulated his fundamental design goal of remaining faithful to the machine, allowing people to use his language without paying for the features they do not need, and eliminating as much as possible the cost of abstraction. So these research goals he combined with gradually incorporating more and more mechanisms for expressing modern abstractions. C++ evolved to a point where we could both talk about low-level representation of our data structures, about bit positioning in memory, and about addresses in the data structure, and at the same time, using advanced algebraic concepts such as, say, semigroups. During this long path, Bjarne was very unwavering, very resolute to preserve his fundamental goals. I remember when I joined C++ community in the mid-80s, people were telling Bjarne, clever people, that he should turn C++ into fully object-oriented language, make it automatically garbage collectible, make all the member functions virtual, eliminate global functions. In other words, they wanted him to design Java. He resisted. He listened politely to them, to me, to other people throughout this lengthy period of time, and kept working, maintaining the fundamental integrity of the language. It became a remarkable tool. At least, I find it so. Hopefully, since you are here listening to me now, you also find it a remarkable tool. Is he done with the language? No. I mean, the design is going and going and going. And that, from my point of view, actually proves its greatness. The fact that the path is open, there are many other things to do, that C++ is a language which could be developed further, shows us that it is a language with the future. Many years from now, it will become so much better even than what it is right now. And for that, I'm very grateful to its designer, a great computer scientist, Bjarne Stroustrup.
It's not easy to follow Alex. He's always thoughtful, and you end up thinking along the ideas he's talking. And here, I have to try and get back to what I was planning to talk about, which has to do with simplification. It might be amusing to you that Bill Joy actually once did suggest I design Java, but that never happened. I noticed that my slides have crept down a bit again, so that you might find a problem later. Anyway, so I have heard many, many clever talks, and I have been in academia and I've seen many, many clever academic papers. And this talk is sort of a reaction to that. Most of the time we are doing relatively simple things, and most of the time we don't really want to be clever. We can usually be either clever or productive, but it's hard to be both at the same time. Similarly, there's a high value placed on thinking outside the box. The problem is, by now, a lot of the good solutions are inside the box. And if you don't use them, you'll never get the time to do something new and constructive outside the box. So, I'm going to try and encourage you to simplify your code and to simplify the way you think about code. And I tried very hard to write a keynote that wouldn't bore you totally stiff without having any clever code in it. I think I slipped up once, but only once. So here's the executive summary. If you go to sleep, that's all you need to know. The rest is details. If things are simple, keep them simple. But don't make more complex and difficult things unnecessarily complex, and really don't make things impossible. Because you can't imagine, when you're building a piece of code, what other people will do with it next year, or the year after, or the next decade. You may not like what they're doing, but they'll do something. And it's really too arrogant to close every possibility for change and extension, because the next guy coming along may have a slightly different problem, or he might be slightly cleverer than we are, or the world might have improved. And the constraint in my world, not in everybody's world, but in my world, is don't sacrifice performance. A lot of us are in C++ because we can do things faster in C++ than in any other language. And by fast here, I mean runtime. There's other measures, but this is the measure I'm thinking about here. Another way of saying this, C++ is expert friendly. It is very friendly to experts, and it's becoming more so. The sets of rules are getting larger, the flexibility is increasing, the opportunities for writing really, really highly tuned performance code is getting better. But C++ must not just be expert friendly. Novices and occasional users and average users, which is people like me on some days, they're very important. They're the majority, always. And so most of the time, I don't want to be a language lawyer. If you ask me a really hard language lawyer question, I'm sure I can answer it in a few minutes. But you know, if I have to look it up in the standard or in one of my own books, that's fine if it's not a question I have to face every day. So don't be a language lawyer. It can actually harm your abilities as a programmer. I was thinking about this in some generality, and here's a quote from Machiavelli. Trying to make significant changes is really, really hard, and for fundamental reasons. The reformer makes enemies, yeah, especially for the people that profit by the old order. I mean, if you don't have to learn anything new, you can be an expert on something that may should have been dead. And the defenders can't quite see where we're going. I mean, if I'm arguing that you should rewrite your code or you should write your next program in a way you don't quite understand yet, you're not going to sort of be too excited because you know there's problems. You'll sort of be biased towards doing it the old way. And there's a lot of old code out there. And we're heavily invested in C++ 98 code, and especially in techniques, tools, and such. I'm very happy C++ 11 is being adopted at an astonishing speed, but there's still a lot of drag here. And then, of course, the best is the enemy of the good. We always try and do it a little bit better, and sometimes it's just a little bit different, just because we used it the other way. Don't go overboard. But we're clever programmers, and we like to write clever code. We don't like to maintain clever code, though. So let's take it easy. And I'm always under pressure of having new features. I think that, to a close approximation, every feature that's ever been useful in any language has been proposed to C++, or at least mentioned to me as something I really, really must get. Fortunately, I resisted most of them. Probably also your favorite feature, but we will see. So that was the there's a bit more of a preamble, but this is the overview. I'm going to discuss what I mean by simple, and I'm going to give three examples and then discuss a little bit about the future. So being too clever is not clever. Brian Kernighan, back in the dark ages, debugging is twice as hard as writing the program. So if you spend all your cycles on writing the program, you can't debug it, you can't fix it, you can't maintain it. And even if you work to the limit of it, unless you simplify it for the next guy that comes along, you'll have to hire somebody smarter than you to maintain it. It's not going to work very well. This was in 1976. By the way, I've worked with Brian for most of the time since 79, and see him quite regularly. You want to design for clarity, and there's two kinds of complexity. There's the essential complexity of the problem. I mean, there are problems that are hard. There are problems that are complicated, and you can't reduce that. Irreducible complexity is a phrase somebody use and very often overuse. But we have to figure out what is the real problem, what is the real way of doing it, what is the simplest solution to the problem. That's great, that's unavoidable. But a lot of complexity is introduced by the way we express our solutions. We may be using a class hierarchy where parameterization is the right solution, or vice versa, we might write a horrible template program where a simple class hierarchy would do. We have to try and match the solution with the way we express our solution. And there is a lot of accidental complexity that creeps in, and this is where how you use C++ or some other language actually matters. That's where you have to understand how to express things. And I just have two comments at this stage. Don't over-abstract. If you want to abstract from concrete examples and make sure you didn't mess up the original solution in the process. I have seen so many designs that ends up with, say, five template parameters that express five nominally orthogonal aspects of the solution. Well, they aren't orthogonal, and the implementation is going to be complicated, and the template parameters are not going to obey all the rules in relation to the others. It can get really bad. So whatever you abstract, make sure that you need to abstract, and make sure you start with something concrete. And once you've finished abstracting, make sure that your abstract solution for the concrete example runs as fast and is as simple as use and as simple to understand as the original. It is amazingly easy to mess up on this. And, you know, when complexity is necessary, at least you can try and hide it. I mean, one of the good things about interfaces, one of the good things about abstractions, is that you can shove the dirt under the carpet where it belongs. I mean, it'll be there somewhere. Complexity doesn't disappear, but you don't have to expose it all the time. Borrowing a quote, I basically want the code to directly express extent, the intent of what you're trying to do. That's sort of as close as I can come to a definition of simplicity. If the code really shows what it is you're trying to do, you've got it right. And simple code is easier to understand. It's often beautiful. It's very often fast. There's people that think when you abstract and when you present something away from the bits and the bytes, it's necessarily slower. The opposite is quite often the case. When you express an algorithm directly, precisely, elegantly, you quite often find that the optimizer is like what you've just done. And an optimizer these days are much better with bits and bytes than you are. Maybe if you spent half a year, you could hand code some code that's better than the optimizer in some case. But is that the way you want to spend half a year? So that's what I'm trying to do. And now let's get to some examples. The idea of using a language to simplify the expression of code is not at all new. And here's an example. When I started with C, when I was starting to think about C++, the traditional style was you declare a variable, and then there's a bit of space for you to mess up and use it before it's initialized. And then you initialize it. I hope you do. And then you remember not to initialize it again somewhere else, which also happens. And then when you're finished, you remember to clean up. Well, maybe you remember to clean up. And then after you've cleaned it up, you better not use it again. And this is easy on one slide, but I found a lot of code in Bell Labs, AT&T at the time, that where every mistake indicated on this slide were done, and you had to do something about it. And my solution turned out to be useful. A constructor establishes a runtime environment for member functions, including acquiring resources if needed. In modern terms, it establishes an invariant. And a destructor reverses the action of the constructor, because if you're dealing with resources, if you're dealing with any state outside your object itself that has to be reversed. If you have to, if you've made a dynamic change to your system in the constructor, you better clean it up. Now, most classes don't actually need a destructor, but important classes do. So the idea was to reduce the code on the previous slide to simply stick X in a scope and be done with it. This means that there's actually errors you can't make. It expresses the programmer's intent. Give me a local variable, get it initialized so that it's a proper object there, and make sure you clean up the mess. It's all directly expressed when you declare X. And it eliminates the classes of errors, use before initialize, can't be done. Double initialization, can't be done. Double destruction. You can do it if you use delete, but I don't do that much anymore. And it creates a couple of new problems. I find that every new solution, every new language feature will create some new problems. It gives clever people things to write about, but you're not going to solve the final problem, and therefore there will be something new. In case of constructors and destructors, it left the problem of what to deal with exceptions and how to stop people from getting into terrible misses by using new and delete. These days, solutions go along the lines, use something like unique pointer and shared pointer. Don't start plugging in a garbage collector and inventing finalizers. That just gets you into deep, deep trouble. But anyway, so in modern code, we can avoid naked news and deletes. One of the ways of looking for bugs in your program is to look for uninitialized variables, but that's shooting fish in the barrel. Next, you look for deletes, because if you got a delete, you probably got it wrong somewhere. And if you can't find the deletes, look for the news, because if you have a new, there should be a delete somewhere. Okay, so that's making it simple. So let's go to some more examples, because I can't talk about simplicity and just wave my hands in the air, because you have to be concrete. So here's an example that a friend of mine sent me about a week ago. He had been working on some production code and wondered what C++11 could do for them in some real code. And here's a slightly simplified version of what was found in the production code. This is code that has been in production, shipped, paid off lots of people's mortgages for a decade. This is not bad code, okay? So they iterate over some memory and looking for a pattern, and they do something if they found it, and do something else if they didn't. The simplification is so that you don't actually have somebody's production code on my slide. So it's a little bit harder to see what's going on in the real code. But let's see what we can do. First of all, we can use auto to so that we don't have to say that horrible std colon colon vector memory buffer colon colon const iterator. I mean, getting that right is hard in itself. So we can just eliminate it. Auto takes care of that. And while that happens, you can now fit your loop head on a single line where it belongs. So this is simpler. You also now have eliminated the possibility of using CIT there outside the loop body where it was meant to be used. If you look at the previous thing, you do not know whether it was meant to be used only in the loop or outside. There might be some clever code that takes advantage of where you exited the loop. If that's what you want, that's what you do. Most of the time, you are in the simple case where you just want to loop through it. So that's the first step. That's easy. Then we can take another step. There's a new construct in C++11 for expressing a regular normal garden variety for loop. That is, if I'm saying for all x in V, then I don't have an iterator. I can't do silly things with iterators like decrementing them in the middle of the loop or something like that to do something clever. If that's what you need to do, do it. If that's not what you need to do, say it's a regular loop so that I can recognize that. I can see it. I don't have to be clever to figure out that there's no silly code messing with the iterator left inside the body. Okay, here, this will not happen. It's a reduced example that fits on a slide, half a slide. If it had been 2 pages long, there'd probably be other problems, but it would be hard to recognize what you're doing. So you look at that, you say, this looks rather familiar. I can do that slightly better. That's a fine diff. So I reduce that to a fine diff, which in many cases runs even faster. It's written by people who are either more clever than I am or had more time to optimize the implementation. And the semantics is documented somewhere, so I don't have to write it. Now, I'd like to point out that anybody could have read the original code and deduced that there really was a find if there. But the fact is that in 10 years of maintenance, they didn't do it. Because by and large, you don't sit looking at your code saying, oh, how do I simplify that by using a standard algorithm or invent an algorithm that can do it? Yes, you should, but reality is that most of us, most of the time, don't. So going gradually through the simplifications here, doing tiny little steps, actually allows us to discover things. It also, by the way, are processes that could be mechanized. You can write tools that does the transformation from the first example to this example, but it's really quite hard to do it in one step. So anyway, I look at this, and it still doesn't quite express what I want to do. I don't actually want to know what C begin is. I just wanted to look for the pattern in V. That's what I wanted. And I have some indication of how you get back, and that getting an iterator back is an all right thing. So I have a lot of code that does something to a whole container. So why can't I say I want to do it to the container, to the range, whatever you call it, rather than bothering saying, oh, there's an iterator here and there's another iterator there and I have to spell them right and such. It's rare I make spelling mistakes in these, but it happens and it is possible to get the sequence wrong. Here, you're not getting the sequence wrong. Okay, the standard doesn't support that directly, but it's fairly easy to do. Here's the way I define a find if. For a range, I call it container because most of the ranges happens to be containers and most of the containers happens to be vectors, of course. But apart from that, it's logically a one-liner with a little bit of boilerplate. So if you want to reduce the code to that simple case, you can. It may have to do like me, write 2 or 3 pages of these things so that I now have it and I don't have to do it again and again and again. Okay, so in this code, there's an iterator const. What's iterator const? It's a template alias, should be in the standard. It's simply defined iterator of T is type names T colon colon iterator. You can improve that, I'm sure. You can generalize it. I know how to do it. But the basic thing is this makes the symbol notation right. I want the container's iterator, iterator of cont. End of story. It's express. No fiddling with type names and other strange rules. It just says what I want to do. Okay. So, having received this in my email, I of course look at it, think, oh, this is really great, and send him the message back. What would you have said 5 years ago if I told you that you could halve the size of that code? Because the other part of the email was, oh, And then we found quite a few cases of this and the code shrank to the half, the production code. Yeah, my example here, teaching example, shrank with a factor of 5, but in a real body of code, he halved the number of code. The answer came back, snake oil. He would not have believed it. But this is not snake oil. The revised version is shipping, is being used. So incremental improvement, I'd like to emphasize that again, and the fact that progress happens. It just does. Okay, so resource management. You know, I'm always talking about resource management because that's one of my focuses. And that just happens to be one of my favorite distributed systems. It has wheels, but it's run by C++. So here is a classical resource management example from C++ 98, and there's a lot of code that looks like that. We want to collect some data, and we want to get it out of a function. This is one of these cases where pointers become attractive because a pointer can be passed very cheaply. So here, I return the pointer to a string, a vector of strings, and inside I just free store, allocate it, fill it up with good stuff, and return it. Maybe you like that style, maybe you don't like that style, and pass in a target container that you fill or something like that. But in either case, you have to explicitly deal with memory allocation, memory deallocation, and to use this code, obviously you now have to say that the vector of string, give it a name strings, collect all the S's in some input, fine. From input. Now I have pointers, so I get pointer notation. I don't particularly like to subscript directly, but point is that they're pointers and you have to deal with them like pointers and you have to remember to delete them. Now we know that in real code, if we have to delete a lot of things, sooner or later we'll forget them and we have a leak. So with C++ 11, the simplification is really quite simple. You give the pointer you get from the collection thing to a shared pointer, and now you can use the shared pointer directly. It's still a pointer, but you don't have to write delete and you haven't forgotten it. It's been taken care of. If you are not actually going to share that pointer with anything, so why do you want the shared pointer and the overhead of a counter? So you can use unique pointer, and that's fine. That's pretty good, but it's still pointers, it's still somewhat verbose. In C++ 11, one of the major features here is move semantics, so we can simply define the container inside the vector, fill it up with good stuff and return it. And the move semantics makes it sure that you can take that container, steal its contents, stick it on the outside and leave an object that's destructible behind. And if you're extra lucky, the return value optimization will make sure that you don't even have to go through the deletion action. So here we have a reliable way of getting lots of information out of code, and that simply it simplifies code, and having simplified it, we can get rid of a lot of code. And so I return containers by values, and that saves me from fiddling with pointers in cases where I used to have to do it. I used to have to fake this, but now the language does it. Is Howard Hinnant somewhere here? Yeah, hi. Thanks, Howard. Okay, again, the crucial thing in this context is the simplification. We can start arguing about whether we can save one byte or one cycle. it's uninteresting. I was moving out potentially millions of bytes. Okay, so people say that's too simple. You don't actually write collect functions like that. You're right, you generalize it. And so here's a good generalization in the STL style. I want to collect something. I want to collect from a sequence, and I want to collect things that matches a predicate. That's fine. That this is the way we often do it. And we can now write that very simple. We return a vector of the value types of the iterators, and the code is the same as it was before. Make a nice container, fill it up with good stuff, return it. This is simpler than anything we've been able to do before. And we now have to test it with a set of alternatives. So I can write a function odd, which tests whether an integer is odd, and I can take a list of integers and test whether and get all the odd ones back. Nice. I can look for the initial S that I was doing before, and I can actually say collect from the beginning and to the end the things that has initial S in it. And there's another little thing here to notice. Auto again comes in, so I don't have to mention what the real type is. But have you ever been bitten by having to use the old paren syntax for creating an object, an iStream or something in this case? That's the thing that couldn't be passed. Use your curly parens when you can. It doesn't have that problem, so it's easily written. Now, what I want. Yeah, of course, I would like to use this for containers again. So I simply write a version that takes a sequence, like a vector or something like that. The code looks the same. I have just simplified the interface so that I don't have to repeat things. And now I can try a few things. The first thing I tried was to say auto SS1, collect the initializer list odd, and it doesn't work because of a missing rule. I actually think that should have been deduced to be an initialize a list of integers, and it should all have worked. But you know, in the committee, you don't win them all. And so now you have to first pick up the initializer list and then collect elements from them down in SS2. Let's see. I then try to do my original example again. As I said, you always have to do when you abstract, you have to be able to do your initial example as well as when you started. I try to collect all the initial S's and CN. It doesn't work. And happens to be that there's a fundamental reason it doesn't work, is that CN does not know what type you're looking for. You have to tell it. And so I am using the iStream range, which is a range of, it's a begin and end of using iterators that looks for string. I can do that. And the way you can also say, give me that range and then use it. And here I just threw in a lambda just to show I could, because if initial S is not actually a useful predicate that you reuse again and requires a name, it's one of these really short ones you only use once, that's what lambdas are good for. And so you can write it like that. To get this work, I actually have to start using traits, and they work as ever. So I give myself a value trait that can be applied to a container, and then I specialize it for pointers, and I specialize it, I define it for something. This is too complicated. Everybody here can write it fairly easily and probably have done so. Anyway, I also need the iStream range that gives me a begin and an end iterators for a given type. So this you bind in an iStream iterator and you create, an iStream and you create iterators for that iStream of the type you specified. This looks very much like C++98. In other words, we've been able to do this for about 15 years. The only thing is we now no longer need that constructor. If you just leave it out and you initialize with a single variable in curlies, it'll be taken care of. You don't actually have to know whether it has a constructor or not. That's fine. Okay, so this is sort of what you can do today. I've used only C++11 and C++98. And that's fine, but for a keynote, you're supposed to also look ahead. So I'm going to talk about concepts. And this is the place where the language probably creaks the most just now. We write generic code, and it's not always pleasant, as everybody who knows what they're talking about mentions. So basically, in 1980, I wrote a little paper about C with classes, and it says you need object-oriented programming with class hierarchies, and you need to be able to parameterize with types so that you can get something like a vector of t, where t is an argument. That's fine. I got the right idea, and my solution was macros, which was a lousy solution. It took me a couple of years to realize that didn't work. And so in 87, I formulated my aims for templates for the mechanism for expressing generic and generative programming and such. It should be extremely general and flexible. As usual, I don't trust my foresight to cover all of your use cases. So if it can only do what I can imagine, it's a failure. Secondly, you need zero overhead. We have to be able to build this so that it works as well as the concrete case. And we need, of course, need well-specified interfaces so that we can do overloading, we can get good error messages, and all of this good stuff. And well, 2 out of 3 ain't bad, but it's not good either. It's bothered me ever since. At the time, I did not know how to get the three at the same time, and I don't think anybody else did either. Usually, they got the interfaces right by imposing overheads. At the time, everybody told me that sort of the right solution is something equivalent to a V table. You just indirect all things through a function call and you can solve it. There's still languages doing that today. So, but we had to do this. I mean, this is important. This is one of the fundamental ways we're writing code. It's one of the fundamental ways we express generalization. So this is worth working on. And templates certainly do have problems. I mean, the syntax is loud. Anybody like typing template sharp type name space t a lot of times? I don't think so. It was not the original syntax, but people really, really want heavy syntax for things they consider new, because new things are dangerous, and therefore new things has to be verbose. I'm not quite sure I believe that argument, but I hear it a lot. Next time you tell me to have a more complicated syntax for a new feature, just think what you would like 2 years later when it's now familiar. But anyway, for templates, there's many workarounds needed for what people are actually doing. People write too many classes, they write too many specializations, they write a lot of boilerplate. And from my perspective, what is even worse is that the syntax is different from any other piece of code you're writing. If I want to have a template that does square roots for numbers, the syntax is different from if I have a function that takes a square root for a number. Not very different, but it's different. And you have to think about it different. The semantics of templates is compile time duck typing. If it walks like a duck and it quacks, it's a duck. Rest of the language is based on types and name types. It's just different. And the programming style is different. And you now have a language where you have sort of two competing synthesis and two competing ways of thinking about code. That's not good. And then, of course, the error messages are spectacularly bad. I fairly recently had an example where there was four lines of code in the relevant function, and I ran it on Cygwin on my Windows laptop, and I never figured out what the error was because it overflowed the console window. That is, I only got the last few thousand lines of error messages, and I never saw the beginning. Okay, now we know some compilers are sort of a little bit old-fashioned and have bad error messages, and modern compilers have better error messages, so I took another compiler, and I had exactly the same experience. It, too, I can only see the last many thousand of error message lines. And it turned out that they were totally misleading. Anyway, and if you write all of that extra boilerplate, you get slow compilation. So we have to do something. But let's not forget, templates has been successful. They've been spectacularly successful. I mean, think about all the pain of templates. Why do people actually suffer that pain? It's because they get something. They get flexibility, they get performance, they get to express things they can't do otherwise. I mean, this is the ultimate proof that things work. I don't think we really are masochists. There's a reason we do this. So we need to express this, provide better support. And as I said earlier, expressing intent is what we want to do. We want to write less code. We want greater flexibility. And having thought about it a bit, my ultimate aim is to make generic programming ordinary programming. That is, we think about it in the same way. We write roughly the same things. This is good. And so we have several remedies going along this way. We're not there yet, but we're getting there. If what you want out of compile time computation is a value, use a constant expression function. Constant expressions have been generalized. You have user-defined type. You have got floating point numbers. You can do that at compile time. If you are wanting a value, don't start writing templates. They're all about types and classes. If you have complicated argument types, you can use variadic templates, and that removes a lot of complicated stuff. If anybody has ever seen Jaakko Järvi's original Lambda library, you will know what I mean. This was one of the reasons Jaakko, with a tiny little bit of help from me, helped get Lambdas into C++ 11. And then finally, we need to constrain template arguments. We want to simplify checking, improved error messages, and enable overloading. And that would leave template metaprogramming, as it's currently looked at, to experts and library implementers, where I believe it belongs. It is, by and large, complicated code. If we can simplify most of the things we do, then it becomes an expert thing. So here's what we have now. If you use concepts as currently designed and implemented. They are not part of C++ 14, unfortunately. I'll get to that. But basically, on about the first day where you learned how to program, you wrote something like this. A square root function takes a double and produces a double. We take something that can be treated as a double, like an integer, and we take the square root of it, and we get the right result. We take something that is not a double, like a pointer to a double, feed it to square root, and the compiler says, no, you can't do that. Square root wants a double. That's it. You understood it on day one or two of your programming career. So I want to do the same thing again. I want to sort a container. And I want to give it something that is a container. Obviously, vector is a kind of container. there's a definition somewhere of what a container is. It's basically something that has a sequence that's a beginning and the end, and you can do random access, and you can compare the elements. That's definition of a container. So I sort VS. VS is a vector of string. A vector of string is a kind of container. It all works. Then I try and sort something that is not a container, like a pointer to a vector. And it says, nope, can't do it. This is not a container, right there. And so there is no fundamental difference in the way we think about these programs and the way we think about write this code. That's where I want to go. So let's see how we do it. We can thank Alex for this. He has been arguing that concepts, that is, requirements on template arguments, is the foundation of generic programming for the better part of 20 years. We just didn't know how to please him. Basically, we need to state intent. We want to explicitly state what we the template definition requires with arguments. We want point of use checking with good error messages, and concepts as they are here are predicates. I mean, think about it. I'm saying I want a container. What's a container? It's something that has a beginning and an end, has random access, and has an element type that you can compare. Those are predicates. Do you have a begin and an end? Do you have random access? Do you have a value type, and does it have a comparison operator? It's all straight questions. So the whole system is built on predicates. So basically, what we are saying is when you write a template, you simply say what questions should be asked by a compiler about an argument type, and the answer is either yes or no. If it's yes, you're happy. If you're no, you're even happier because it's found a bug right there and you can fix it. And there was a failed attempt in C++ to create a concept system. And there's been failed attempts to create concept system in many, many places, failed relative to the requirements of C++. So we, meaning mostly Andrew Lumsdain and Alex Stefanov, Sean Parent, me, several others, decided we were actually not going to design a language feature. We were going to study the problem first. We're doing a requirement analysis on the problem of what to do with template arguments. So we went to Palo Alto, where Alex works, and said, okay, we will specify the whole set of algorithms in the S tier. And we'll figure out a notation for doing this, and we'll just specify it. That's the exercise. If we have a good specification of the standard library, we know what we want. And then Alex turns around and says to me, now you go and design it. But first we have to have the solution, right? We have to have the use case. And so if you go and look up, there is something called the colloquially called the Palo Alto TM, which has a title with concepts in the name. The editors is me and Andrew Sutton. You can find a specification of the standard library. And then we went away, me, Andrew, and Gabidos Reis, who at that time all worked very near each other in TAMU and College Station, and we designed the current system, and Andrew went away and implemented it. You can download the implementation and try and use it. And we are getting it through the committee. That takes time, it's a bit painful, but we should have the right votes in November, so we will meet the 14 deadline for some definition of meeting it. Okay, so what is it? Here's an example. A concept is a predicate, and there's a predicate saying T, sequence of T means, is T a sequence? Yes or no? It's just a Boolean expression. It breaks down into things like, do you have a begin, do you have an end, and things like that. And so now I can define a template, find. The definition of find you find in the standard, so I just have to translate it into the syntax here and then use it. So I say I need two type names, S, which is the name of the sequence, and T, which is the type of the value. Oh, I've reduced it to a container range a version of the algorithms. One, because I think it's the most common case, and two, because it fits on the slide. And then we need to say, what do we require? What does find require from S, the type of the sequence, and T, the type of the value that we are trying to find? And it says requires sequence of S. Yep, S has to be a sequence. And we have to be able to compare with equal the value type of S to our T, the thing we met. Yep, that's what we are going to do. So that's how we express it. And now we can say find Jabberwocky in a vector of strings, and it'll all work nicely. Okay, error handling. A lot of people think this is all about error handling. You have noticed that my perspective, it's all about how to specify code and write code and think about code. But you get good error messages. So here, I'm taking back to the sort example. Basically, there has to be a type that is sortable. Sortable is one of these predicates. Sortable of Kant means that you have to have, you have to be a sequence, right? We said what that is. It has to be a random access sequence. And the element, there has to be an element type that you can compare. So we know we can do that. So I make a vector of doubles and a list of integers, and I say sort the vector. Is a vector a sortable sequence? Yep, it is. Everything is fine. We're home. Is a list a sortable sequence? No, it is not. And the punchline is you can get the error message in red there. The thing that's wrong with this code is that list of int does not satisfy the constraint sortable. And you can set the compiler flag, at least last time I looked, to give you more information about why a list of int is not sortable, and it'll tell you that a list does not have random access. So once you've got this, you can do all kinds of things. You can define your own concepts. And there was a talk yesterday where Andrew, who's right there, would have told you all about it. So if you had had a lot of foresight, you've been there. If not, you can either watch the video or take out your time machine and go back and listen to it. But that's where it is. Your concepts are simply compile time constant expressions. You can use the standard library type traits to build up interesting predicates. And you can test for valid expressions. There is a thing called requires, which is a predicate. You give it an expression, and it tests whether that expression will compile. So now you can write all kinds of interesting requirements on for use it. Now, actually, you can write two interesting requirements. This is going to go out of control, but we'll get back to that later. It is very powerful and interesting. And yes, there will be a standard library of concepts. Andrew has got one. It's not standard yet, but it's a library of concepts, and it can handle the STL. No, concepts are not base classes. Notice I did not say go home, rewrite vector to use container or sort it as a base class. No. This is imposed afterwards. If vector has the properties required of a sortable, then it is a sortable. It's just a set of predicates you apply, and it's not Java, C-sharp interfaces, and it's not just a set of function signatures. You can ask if there's types that are member types. You can ask for more complicated properties. But anyway, if you want the details, you should have done the two-hour version, not the 20-minute version of this talk. So I'll move on blithely here. Now, what if you actually wanted to sort the list? One thing you get out of a proper type system, as we're getting here, is that you can sort of choose between alternatives. And so the standard says that you sort something that's sortable. What if you only have a sequence? That is, instead of a sortable sequence, you have a sequence. Then you can always copy it over into a vector, sort it, and copy it out again. That's usually the best way of sorting something that you can't, where it's expensive to traverse. And now, with that piece of code there, you can sort the vector and you can sort the list, and we can have a nice long debate about whether it's wise to have such a facility, because it makes an expensive operation easy to write. But that's a different philosophy. Concepts work for lambdas. That was one of the conditions. After all, these days, people write lambdas where they would have written functions before, and in places where they couldn't write functions. So it's no good to define a system for dealing with generics that can't handle lambdas. So here we have a function that starts up inc 1, adds 1 to a number. Number is defined somehow. A number is something you can add, subtract, multiply, divide, and has some semantic properties that makes it a number. And so if I say increment 4, I will get 5. And with a lambda, we can define a plus. Here it takes a number, and I have a nested lambda here that adds the two lambdas. And this is where I think I probably am being more clever than I should be for this talk. I borrowed it from a posting by Chris Kolab on ISO CPP last week. So if now say plus 4, it returns a lambda that will add 4 to whatever you give it as an argument. And then I can say increment 4 with 2, and I get a 6. Or I could simply get 10 by saying plus 4, 6. Okay. This kind is powerful, it's clever, it possibly too clever, but it shows that using this kind of notation, you can actually constrain lambdas as well as functions. This stuff is general. And as you may have noticed, different people have different ideas of what's simple. There are people who will swear blind that this is simpler than the way we usually add two numbers. Now, I'd like to point out that auto is the least constrained concept. So if you take away what I was saying about constraining the arguments and just take an unconstrained argument, that is called auto, and the whole thing works again. Exactly like before, the only reason is the only problem is you might get slightly worse error messages. And can't help showing off, but I proposed auto like that in 2002. The evolution group sounded like the Duchess that's just seen a mouse. But things take time, and we're getting a very powerful type system, very good checking, very good overloading. So here is an illustration of the idea of making simple things simple. We have a very general mechanism where we say we have a type name, here are the predicates required by the type, and here's the way we use the type. The first simplification is that we say we want something a type that's sortable of a name. So we take away the first two lines. Why do we first introduce a type name and then say what the requirements are? If the requirements have a simple name, we simply mention it. The second version of sort will, like the first, take any thing that is sortable. And finally, we can have what's called the terse notation, which is where we're simply saying, I want something sortable, and it then means exactly the same as the same thing. Now, the first notation will allow you to write a much larger set, at least a larger set, of programs and write more complicated code. The second will shorten the code for the cases where it is simple, and the shortest notation there simplifies it to the actually what I think is the most common and simplest case. We can argue about most common. It'll take us 10 years to know who was right if we have this argument. If you look at it from a language point of view, you just reverse it. Sort of sortable means there has to be a sortable type, and we sort that, which means that there must be a type name that meets the predicate sortable, and we use that type. So if you are a compiler, you will do this transformation, and internally everything is worked out in the details below. And you can choose the notation that's most appropriate to you. So let's look at what challenges I think we're facing now. Misuse. People look at new features. They look at auto, they look at the concepts, and imagination goes riot with what kind of trouble these are going to cause. I mean, how could we have programmers do this? This is too complicated. Nobody can think their way through it. You will sound like my colleagues at Bell Labs when I tried to explain virtual functions to them. Every powerful new feature can and will be misused. We cannot avoid that. That is just the way things are. I mean, just look and see what they've done to the innocent C for statement. It's very complicated. You have loop variables that are not restricted to the loops. You can change the loop variables inside the loop. You can have conditions missing, all of that. Obviously, this is dangerous and horrible, and nobody can do it right. We've lived with it for 40 years. We can do better in some cases, but you know, we get used to it. Virtual functions, we got used to it. Templates, we've even gotten used to templates. So basically, new things happen. A lot of them are improvements. So get used to it. Be careful in the beginning till you know what you're doing, till you know what the implications are, and learn. More about learning. And every feature and tool was new once. There's a fairly familiar tool there, which of course cannot be misused. When you start out with new stuff, be a little bit careful. Try to pick the low-hanging fruit. Try to start out by not doing the old stuff for which there are improved versions, like use the new for loop when you can, use auto to stop stop repeating types and things like that. And then next you can start removing the old stuff the way my first example did. They looked at the code and gradually removed complicated code, always making sure that they have improvement and that performance is maintained. You need mechanical help for that in general. So a lot of us are talking about static analysis and code transformation. You'll see I was writing about that 10 years ago, but now it's really coming. This is good, and then you can do two things. You can mechanically transform code into more modern code. Some people call that modernization, I tend to call it rejuvenation, something like that. And where it is not possible, where the static analyzer says, this code is too complicated for me to understand, you may want to look at it, because if the static analyzer can't understand that code, can you? Did the guy who wrote it in the first place understand it? Bugs hide in dark corners and in messy code. So this way of trying to modernize code, rejuvenate code, is an opportunity to find latent bugs. And if you do a bit of this, then you can gain credibility. That's really important in an organization. Nobody will let you loose on a 100,000 line code base just because you say it's cool and that somebody told you at a conference. Gain credibility by picking the low-hanging fruit. So what if you're not allowed to use any of the new stuff? There's always reasons people don't want to let you use the new stuff. You run into people that think that GCC 3.4 is basically the end development of programming. And if you move from that, all hell breaks loose. They may be right about the all hell breaking loose, but you know, you have other problems then. Because you can't maintain your code, you can't use modern features, you can't use modern tools, you can't use modern optimizers. Ooh, you're in trouble. But anyway, there's always reasons. And basically, I'm recommending find a way that point out the costs of using old code. If nothing else, if you have to write in a sort of 1995 style, which is roughly what you get in C++ 98, you're going to piss off the best programmers. They would rather like something that's better, and they know it exists in C++ and sometimes elsewhere. So find a way. This is a fight that's worth fighting. And one thing that is worth thinking about is that when you write code, I think far too often we write in a style that's restricted to what we can actually do just now, as opposed to writing in a style that we know will be better supported soon, and we can actually think about our design in slightly more idealized terms and then map it into what we've got. So I think you can design for C++ 14 plus the TSs, in particular the concept TS. These days when I write a template, I write template DDD and then slash slash, and then I write the requires clause that I would want. If I'm just doing it in my local code base, I can take the slash slash away because I can use Andrew's compiler. Otherwise, I can wait a year and then I can take the comments away. The formalized comments are better than English comments because formalized is far more precise and it's terser. And next year you can take the comment away. So try and design for a more ideal language and hope that ideal language will come into existence and become available to you. So obviously C++ 14 plus concepts, but what about C++ 17? Especially if you're thinking in terms of concurrency. Do you really want to program with threads and locks forever? I don't think so. You can look at what's coming and try and think in those terms and use libraries to simulate desired features. I have mentioned before that I really, really dislike the visitor pattern. It's intrusive, it's slow, it's a pain to write, there's things you can't do very well with it. It's a horrible workaround for the fact that virtual functions has to be inside a class, and I've grumbled about that for well over a decade. But sometimes there's solutions, and if you like functional programming, you probably like pattern matching. And my then student, Yuri Zlotny, who's here somewhere, wrote a very nice library for open pattern matching. That so you can actually do pattern matching in C++ today. It's a C++ 11 library, so you can use it, it's conforming. It's not as good as if it was implemented in the language itself, but it's still good enough to run as fast as OCaml or Haskell, if it's pattern matching you want. It'll be better if we get the language facilities. So what next? Think. And then think again, build, think again, experiment, think again. It's not easy to make significant changes. And especially if what you want is simplification as opposed to another expert level feature for you and your two best friends. So a lot of thinking to be doing. And here's sort of a list of things where I would like simpler to use high up here. Type and resource safe, of course. I really think our concurrency models are not up to snuff. We need to improve distribution, linking. Oh yeah, speed, we always want speed. I mean, I'm not going to sell speed for just about anything, portabilities, libraries, and basically we need better community building. The C++ Foundation is a beginning. This conference is a beginning. I hope to see a better and more active C++ community. We're already seeing some of that pay off in the committee. And then there's some information sources here. There are the isoCPP.org, where you should go very often. I'm not saying you have to have it as your homepage, but I certainly have it as to click right on top of mine so that I can go and see the latest stuff coming along. There's all the information related to the standard. And there's my site, which is not as active, but has a lot of useful information. I'm particularly proud of the book that came out, A Tour of C++, which describes C++ in 180 pages. Get a copy, read it on the plane back. It can be read in a few hours on a plane. And then there's the ISO site, WG21 is the name of the official name of the committee. Go there, read all the papers, get thoroughly confused, but all the information is there. And that's it for now. Questions?
Hi. Thank you so much for the presentation. These words of wisdom are really important to all of us. I had a question about concepts and the example where you showed us you can have a template type, sortable, where you specify the clause require sortable. And then in the end, it goes down to void sort sortable C. That notation makes me a little uncomfortable because what if sortable is a class?
Sortable is a concept.
Right, but then it looks as if
sortable here is the name of a set of predicates, or it is a predicate.
But how do you differentiate between a type and a concept now? We're throwing it all into the same bag.
In the same way I distinguish between a type and a non-type in the language. There's a keyword concept that allows you to say that it is a concept, and then it knows if you see it in that position, it is a concept and not a type.
And
it's a fairly easy thing for a compiler to do, and it's fairly easy for humans too.
I see. And would you need to fully scope concepts?
It's scoped.
Okay.
Scope, and they will usually live in namespaces, by the way. I probably don't want all of your concepts, and you probably don't want all of mine. So the usual scope rules apply.
So I really liked your example on simplifying simplifying code and getting the intent of the code out there. But in my opinion, you stopped one step before the end. The looking through there and calling find if and comparing to the end. But really, what that code is asking the question, do any of the elements in this sequence satisfy this predicate? That's what it did. It returned a Boolean, said it was true if anything satisfied it, and false if none of them did it. And so pre-C++14, I would have been very tempted to write a templated function called anyOf that just returned the Boolean, because that's so much easier to read. And it expresses the intent of what the code is trying to do. And actually in C++14, the standard library has one of those.
One, it was a real example. Mm-hmm. It was not constructed as something where I could come with the ultimate solution. Secondly, I was emphasizing the incremental nature of that. Once you know about all of and where to look it up, you can go and look it up. People that wrote the original code knew about findIf. Mm-hmm. They didn't think about it, because the original code was sufficiently complicated and large that the fact that it was a findIf was obscured. So this is partly a learning experience. It may very well be that I should take the next step and saying, oh yeah, and there is, what is it, all of. And I didn't. I didn't think about it. My friend that did it didn't think about it. So yes, there's another step. And it might even be even better, but we didn't get there. It was a real example.
Right. And I think my comment about it being in the standard library was kind of a red herring, but what I find, and the incremental improvement was really instructive, but when I get down to the end of that, I sometimes look and say, what is the semantics here, given a name, I agree. That's what I meant.
You should know the algorithms, you should use algorithms more, you should recognize more algorithms, and you should write more algorithms. However, mm-hmm. we don't always do it. And this was a way through. I was thinking about existing code and how to improve it. And the first and the last example were real running code, except for a slight simplification of the actions done.
Sure.
In the two cases.
Thank you.
So I think this is called a violent agreement. We can argue about it forever, but we agree.
When you created the specification concepts for the standard library, when you did that work, how many roughly concepts did you come up with to satisfy the standard library? And also, how did that compare to the work that had been done for C++ OX concepts?
Okay, one of the starts of this project was a rant I had in front of poor Andrew Sutton in my office, saying, 120 concepts in the standard library. This is crazy. Algebra doesn't have 120 concepts. And I wrote down for a couple of domains, including the STL, what I wanted, and I wanted 12. I think when Andrew and I was finished, we had 16. I don't know what the standard concept, the number of concepts for the STL algorithms is. It's less than 24. And some of them are convenience concepts, like mergeable, which is simply combines others for better notation. But we're talking about somewhere between a dozen and two dozen. And we're talking about improvement in between factor of 10 and factor of 5. This really is progress. And a lot of it was done at the Palo Alto meeting by a lot of people. There were some of the names there. You can download the paper from the WG21 site and see the full list. It's about three dozen people involved. So a lot of credit goes to a lot of people.
Excellent speech. I really appreciate it. This is a subjective question, and I just would like your opinion. It comes down to maintainability versus simplification, and it has to do with explicitly stating move and forward semantics versus accepting the implicit forward and move semantics for the universal references and or R-value references. I would personally lean towards explicit so that it's the intent is understood in the code, but that tends to add a little bit of more typing. And whatever your opinion is interesting, so I would like to know what your subjective opinion is of that.
Let me talk a little bit and then I'll ask you if I actually answered the question. The examples I gave were chosen because expressing intent somewhat more clearly led to simplification. And I'm sure it leads to better maintainability. I mean, my end examples are more maintainable than my before examples.
I agree.
And I actually think a lot of the discussions about sort of clever details about how to pass arguments and such are sort of misguided and distracting. And I'll recommend you to see Herb Sutter's endnote on that subject. It doesn't quite fit into what I'm talking about now. Does that answer?
I believe that would be an acceptable answer, yes.
Thanks.
So when you look at C++ 11 or 14, you see many new
features. I'm having trouble hearing you.
Okay, I'll try to be a little louder. When you look at C++ 11 or 14, you see many new features for generic programming, and not a lot of new features for the good old hierarchies of named types. So do you think this indicates that in the future, C++ programming practice will be more towards duck typing and generic programming, or will it stay as it is?
That is, of course, a big question. I think that the main reason for the emphasis on generic programming in C++11 was that that was the area of programming that had most dramatically increased in importance and scope. And therefore, it really required much more attention. The standard kind of object-oriented programming, I think, are actually fairly well supported. And with the exception of the horrible visitor pattern, I'm reasonably happy with it. There are other directions that would have been very different that we could have done, such as dynamic reflection. And basically, the committee feeling was that was not where we particularly wanted to go. You're going to get some of that via static reflection because there's a lot of type properties and work on how you could generate yourself an I/O set of functions for a class instead of if you need it. So I think that explains the past. I think for the future, there's a lot of work going on in concurrency and simpler concurrency models. I really think that threads and locks are the worst way of writing code, except that's what we do all the time and we must do it because that's what the system does. We made it type safe in C++ 11. C++ 17 will have simpler models of that. And some of the language changes is driven by the need to do concurrency better, and of course also simply with the use of C++ 11.14. The thought about C++ 14 was simply that we needed to finish C++ 11. When we ship a big project, there are features that can't get in because we have to ship. And there are things we just don't learn till we try using it for real. And C++ 14 takes care of that. 17 is the next that has major features. Notice a brand new model of how to do standards, ship on time, deliver good stuff, have implementations ready when the standard comes out or before. This is brand new. I think a lot of the credit goes to Herb Sutter for proposing that and managing to talk the committee into changing that pattern, because till now, no other ISO committee has been able to do this. So I'm very happy about the state of the compiler and tools situation, much happier than I was a few years ago.
Exception handling. So do you have anything new coming for that? Because right now there is nothing like null reference exception even. And every time I see a crash term, it's mostly access violation. And it is harder to figure out if we have more exception things coming at with C++ features.
Not sure I understand what you're saying.
So
we have not any real plans for changing the exception handling. We backed off from exception specifications, which were pretty horrendous in real use, and they're deprecated. We put in no except in place, which seems to be manageable, but we're still learning a few things about it, which is, by the way, a simplification. And I don't know of any proposals for fundamental changes in the way we deal with exceptions.
Right. Like, for example, for find if example that you had, if that throws an exception, something like that can be handled. Is there any thought about the feature in next release or anything like that?
Find if?
Yeah, like the one example that you had where you had find if, and if that pattern you are looking for, that throws an exception or something, there is some null reference there. So those
those kind of crash terms that I see regularly, and I have to.
If it throws an exception, the exception should be caught somewhere. Your system crashes. That's I think the right solution. I don't want to decorate my code all over the place with exception handlers. Okay. There are people who have had languages where exceptions were used to terminate loops. I don't want to go there.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that specific exception that happens, like different types of exception that the language has.
Well, I'm not sure I understand, but we have no proposed changes in that area. If some code I call throws an exception, either I am preparing to handle it, in which case I write a try block, or I put some resource handle in place or something like that. Or I'm saying, if it happens, there's nothing I can do locally to handle this, I will clear up, free my resources using RAII and let somebody else deal with it. That's the general strategy, and I don't see any changes to that.
Okay, thank you.
Resource allocation as initialization is probably my favorite feature in C++, but it's a horrible term, and so is RAII. Could you offer an alternative?
You need a time machine. And then you go back to somewhere in the 80s and give me a better term, and I'll use it. Today, I am convinced that even a better term would not be used. And there has been at least half a dozen suggestions. My favorite is Kevlin Henney's execute around, but that's too long, so that'll get abbreviated. And anyway, he didn't think about it till a few years after I came up with my horror. And it's too late. Pick something else. RAII it is. Sorry.
The question about exceptions reminded me of one of my pet peeves, although I haven't really done my homework on this, so hopefully you can clear up a misunderstanding I have. But vectors, I think the vectors move constructor is guaranteed to be no throw as long as the elements are no throw move constructor. There's some interaction between between no accept and between what operations you have available to you, or the efficiency of those operations. And no accept accept.
It can get hairy, and there's several things going on. There's a fundamental thing, what does no accept say? I would like to say that no accept says that it is not supposed to throw, and if it does, I'm willing to crash the program. And that is a perfectly valid way of dealing with a lot of errors. So in my program, I'll be perfectly willing to have vector copy be no accept. Because if I can't get memory for basic things like copying a vector, then my program should crash. Now, the standard cannot say this. So the third thing that comes in is the thing that what can the standard say, because it doesn't know whether it's acceptable to terminate a program or not. And you get some interactions that we haven't quite worked out yet. I would like to use no accept for anything where I consider it a fundamental, fatal design error if it throws. The standard library cannot quite be that brutal.
I guess I was wondering about inferring no accept. Like if I have a function, like right now, if my copy constructor or my move constructor, all it does is, is put s.
Okay.
Right?
Again, if I'd gotten my druthers, it would have been a little bit different and simpler, and all move constructors would have been no accept. And that would have been the rule, end of it. And that means you can't fall back and copy if you can't move. If you have a throwing copy constructor, which you often have because it needs to acquire resources to make the copy, that would have had different implications, but that's water under the bridge. Okay. Last two questions.
I have one question about now that we have lambdas, which allows us to do anonymous fast typing of functors, do you think we can have something similar for RAII classes? Something similar to the scope exit error feature in D?
Yeah, I think so. I think more people should read the C++ programming language 4th edition. Among other things, it has a class called Finally. It takes an action, and it executes it when it goes out of scope. I got fed up with being told that we don't have Finally in C++, so I wrote it. It's about this many lines. And yes, it wouldn't be a bad thing to have in standard, because one of the things you use it for is things like if you have to use malloc for some reason, there's places where the fact that you could possibly throw an exception from new means that they use malloc. If you use malloc, how are you going to get RAII? And the answer is you simply say finally in the lambda that says delete P, free P. So, yeah, I think it has a place.
Yeah, and just one more quick question. This is also a cool feature I've seen in D. That's the one with mixed scenes and the way it can actually get the thread of macroses. Do you think we can have something similar where it allows you to compile the compiler to actually compile a string that's typed or generated at compile time instead of using macroses?
Are you asking if I think we can get an alternative to macros?
Yes. I've seen one in the D language. It's called mixin, so you have a string there and it just compiles it in place where you call it.
I would like to get rid of macros completely, but I don't yet know how to do it. And especially in code transformation, code modification, it's quite difficult to transfer ideas from one language to another, but this is something that we should probably think about, and if you have an idea of something that might eliminate macros completely, I think you should write it up and present it to a few people.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
I just wanted to ask about code generation, but I got anticipated, so you have answered my question. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Okay, thank you. Break time.